Hey, Cheryl, where is our crew?
Here's some music. What's going on?
He's a prison shaking savior. He got chains. He's a
chainbreaker.
Hey, guys.
I know that song. Chainbreaker, Zach Williams. I love it.
So good.
You guys sounded great.
So good.
And did you know that Cheryl's going to be interviewing Zach on today's show?
No way.
Yes way, okay. But we got a show to do. Let's go.
Let's do it. Let's do it.
Zach Williams has been on the fast track to success since he wrote the mega hit song Chainbreaker with two friends. It set a record for the longest running number one debut single from a debut artist. His album by the same name won a Grammy. Zach, so great to have you with us.
Yeah, thanks for having me.
Tell me about this crazy ride since Chainbreaker and the Grammy. Like, you've been on a wild ride of success.
Yeah, it has, it really has. We were just talking before this, I just finished up singing vocals for a second record, and I don't feel like I've stopped since Chainbreaker went to radio 3 years ago. So,
wow,
it's been a whirlwind. Looking forward to the day where I can actually sit back and just kind of take it all in. But right now, I feel like I don't want to slow down while it's all while I got the momentum. I want to keep going with it.
If you got pain, he's a pain taker. If you feel
So tell me about Chainbreaker, because I love that song. It really touches my heart, the words of it. Tell me about the inspiration behind it.
Yeah, so I wrote that song in 2000 and I feel like 15 or 16. Me and my wife were part of a prison ministry at our home church back in Arkansas. And I was working for a church at the time, and I was driving back and forth to Nashville to write every couple of weeks. And I feel like maybe the third or fourth time that I came over to Nashville to write some music, I'd been there for a week, and it was a Friday, and I remember Jonathan Smith, who I'd been writing music with, said, well, hey, we're going to write with a girl named Mia Fields on Friday. You're going to love her. So I, like, Googled her and checked her out, and she'd written all these, like, massive songs for people, and I was honestly like a nervous wreck going into to write songs with her on a Friday. I remember thinking, I don't have anything left in the tank. Like, every idea I had, I wrote already this week, so, like, what am I going to do? And I remember we sat in a room, me and Jonathan and Mia, for like 2 hours just talking about my testimony and what God had done in my life. And at the time, me and my wife were very involved in the prison ministry. And I remember sharing that with them. And Mia just kind of blurted out, well, you should write a song called Chainbreaker. And I kind of laughed. She was like, I'm serious. And I was like, we really write a song called Chainbreaker? She was like, write anything you want. And so I remember Jonathan turned around and played the first lick on the piano, and when he did, I sang the first line of the song just kind of off the top of my head, and they were like, what'd you say? And so we turned around and we started writing, and 15 minutes later we had that song written. And I drove back to Arkansas, and I remember just praying that you know, God would take this song all over the world. And here we are 3 years later. So it's, like I said, it's been a wild ride.
Well, you grew up Christian, so you grew up in this faith, but it wasn't really connecting with you. Tell me about what the disconnect was between your upbringing and your life.
Yeah, so I grew up in I have an amazing mom and dad that at a very early age really, you know, gave me they planted the seed and gave me the roots. And, you know, I was in church every Sunday. I was in church every Wednesday. My dad led worship. My mom sang on a praise team. I was in and out of growth groups and life groups. I can remember being in home church. Like, it just seemed like that's all we did. I grew up, some of the first music I listened to was people like Michael W. Smith, Petra, DeGarmo and Key. I remember my dad took me to a Petra concert when I was like 7 years old. And that's really all I knew, that and sports. I wanted to play basketball. I wanted to get a scholarship. And I thought if I could get a scholarship, it would take me out of the small town that I lived in. Unfortunately, somewhere along the way, 10th, 11th grade, I kind of got to running around with some of the, you know, the wrong crowd, and I found myself using drugs and alcohol. And before I knew it, I'd lost a Division I scholarship to play basketball and dropped out of high school and was working a construction job. And honestly, just thought my life was over. And that's kind of where God steps in. You know, he has plans for your life, and if you allow him to use you, you'll turn it all around. And for me, it was music that really drew me in and got my attention. Like, I was working for my dad's construction company for a year. I got a chance to go to a junior college and try out for a basketball team. And I tried out, I made the team, got a full scholarship to go 3 hours away from home. And then as soon as school started, I found myself right back in the same situation I was in high school, partying every night, trying to outdo the other guys to impress somebody or this or that. And the day before my freshman season started, I tore 5 ligaments in my ankle, and it pretty much ended my basketball career. And that freshman season, though, I remember sitting in my apartment, and my roommate had this guitar that sat in the corner of our room, and I picked it up, and I got a chord chart, and I posted it on my wall, and I sat at the foot of my bed for a year, taught myself how to play guitar. And fell in love with music. I just fell in love with the idea of writing these stories of these seasons of life that you're going through. But I also started justifying my drug use, my alcohol use, like everything. I thought, well, if I'm going to be a rock star, now I can do all this stuff because this is what goes with it. And I did that for over 10 years of my life. I lived hard and reckless, and it was in my early 30s. I was 29 years old. I met my wife, and she had 2 small kids when we met, and I was lost, she was lost, and for some reason God put us both together. And you know, it's crazy how things worked out. I can remember I was getting ready to go on a tour to Europe in 2012. I'd been just living this horrible lifestyle, and I thought, you know, here I am, I've finally made it. You know, you'd think I'd be the happiest thing in the world. I'm on tour in Europe with the band I've been traveling in for years. Instead, I found myself at like one of the lowest points of my life. And I remember my wife was pregnant with our daughter at the time, and this was our 4th child together. And she said, you know, I don't think I can continue to support what you're doing if you don't make some changes. And I remember having this kind of come to Jesus moment while I was on a bus in Europe, and I was like, you know, God, if you're real, like, I need you to prove it. Like, I believe you're real, but I need you to show it to me, kind of. And I was listening to some music on my headphones. I took my headphones off, and our bus driver was scanning radio stations and hotel room and looking up that song on a computer and listening to it over and over. And I called my wife, and I said, I'm done. Quit my band, coming home. And I came home, and we never looked back, and we started going to this church in our hometown, and we just got ourselves involved in everything that there was to do. And over the course of about 3 years of being at that church, everything that's happened now started happening. I started getting opportunities to lead worship. I was asked to be a part of a church campus, and then I was asked to be part of a church launch, and then they gave me a full-time job as a campus director. And then the next thing I know, I'm coming to Nashville to write music, and 3 years after that, we're sitting right here doing this. So it's been one thing after another that God has just done in myself and my family's life over the last 7 years now, that it's kind of gotten to the point of like, okay, like, you know, he kind of has this like way of like saying, how dare you doubt me? Like, I'll show you what I can do. So it's been pretty cool. To know that the songs that I'm writing are being used the way that, you know, I hoped when I was writing them. When you get to hear the stories from, you know, some of these men in prison that we get to go in and play these music for, or you get to hear a kid tell their story of how they were thinking about suicide and they heard Fear's a Liar. I mean, that's, to me, that's where the satisfaction comes in. There's nothing better than that. There's no award or recognition you can get that's better than hearing a story that is linked to something that you wrote, that God gave you a message to share with people.
I think I relate to your story because I also was a person who left the faith of my childhood and did some crazy stuff. And I think there's a lot of parents probably watching who's maybe have kids or grandkids that are kind of like not where they should be and are worried. What kind of encouragement would you have for them about, I guess, parents who pray? I'm sure your parents were praying their guts out for you.
That was it. That, I say that a lot from stage. Like, I think that's the biggest thing. Pray for your kids. Like, God, those prayers don't go unanswered or unheard. I think a lot of times we're praying for our children wanting to see the result right then, but it's not always that way. Like, God has his timing, and he's going to answer that prayer in the moment that it needs to be answered. And for my parents, it was 33 years later, you know, of a constant prayer over my life. And, you know, I know there were days in my dad and my mom's life where they were like, what have we done, like, wrong? Like, we've been faithful and done everything you've asked, and why is he doing this and why is he going through that? But they never give up. They never gave me an ultimatum or they made me feel like they were judging me. They just always prayed for me and loved me. And I think that's the biggest thing you can do as parents is just, you know, give them those roots when they're young and give them something to come back to. And if they wander off, you know, see the world, they at least know, you know, where home's at. And for me, that was, you know, that was Jesus. That was my faith.
So good. Thank you so much for coming today and sharing your story. It's been such a pleasure.
Thank you. Appreciate it.
What a great interview and great testimony. He's listening to Big Daddy Weave on a bus. And as he says, has his come to Jesus moment. And then he's just written some amazing songs. And, you know, beginning here, we were singing in our green room, we call it, Chainbreaker. And then to hear how that is tied into prison ministry, I know, because I like that song, listen to it all the time. And I think as I listen to it again, it's going to, you know, be a little different because you're thinking, really, the chains are broken when you come to Jesus.
Yeah, such a change in life. You know, one of my favorite sayings is that your today is not your forever. Yeah. But I heard another one over the holidays, which is your yesterday is not your tomorrow. Mm. So where you've come from, the experiences that you've been through, sometimes, like he said, I thought my life was over. That's not true. And we can make a change anytime that we just decide that, you know what, it's going to be a different tomorrow. So that's what we want to challenge you with today. He's not unique. Well, he is unique, but he's not alone. That God sees every single one of us and that he can write a new tomorrow for each one of us. If that's you and you just say, you know what, I need a fresh start in this new year. I need to leave some things that happened in the past, and I want a fresh life. Man, that is what God promises. That's exactly what he promises because he knows that we need it. Give our prayer lines a call right now. That number is 1-866-273-4444. We would love to be part of rewriting a new story for you.
I love that, Cheryl. And yeah, chains are being broken. People are coming to know Jesus. You know what? We could all use some organization. You've seen my desk. Anyway, especially in this new year, here's Maggie John with a professional organizer to give us some pointers.
Morgan is back and she says, delete the word busy from your vocabulary. Don't say it anymore. She says, we have the power to choose a life of fullness and put aside things that overwhelm us and make us busy. Welcome back, professional organizer Morgan Tyree, author of the new book, Take Back Your Time. Hey, Morgan.
Hi.
So why do we need to delete the word busy?
Well, I just think it's become a bit of a buzzword, and it almost has this implication that it's happened to us. And I just want to encourage people to remember that we get a choice with our schedule and our commitments. I say in my book that time management's nickname is choices. So if you feel busy, I just encourage people to just take a step back and ask themselves why they're busy, why their schedule looks the way it does.
Do you feel like the word busy has also almost become like a status symbol? Like when people ask you, hey, how are you doing? Oh, I'm busy. It's like almost to make yourself feel important.
Exactly. I feel like it almost just kind of becomes this filler word or this kind of almost excuse maybe. And I feel like rather than us recognizing that our time is really an opportunity we have and that we get to choose how we use it rather than just act like it's happening to us, you know, and I don't want us to fall into that for sure.
So you say the response needs to be seek a sense of harmony in your schedule. How do you do that?
So I think it's just being really self-aware as far as what you're capable of adding to your schedule and even looking at your entire family or your household as far as what your kind of capacity is as an individual or as a family and saying what does harmony look like for us or for me? and knowing, again, going back to the season of life, knowing what you're being called to do. I think we kind of know when we have that sense of peace in our life. And I'm not saying we're going to have this day in and day out. I mentioned in the book that I feel like there's days that I have a day number one where like things are clicking along and I'm feeling like, you know, my planning and things are happening. And then I have a day number two where nothing goes as planned, you know, and I think no matter how much we try, we'll still have some of both days, you know? And so we're not going to always have harmony, but if we're intentional and if we're careful with our yeses and nos, we can have more harmony and less hustle.
Yeah. You also talked about this earlier in the week, but be discerning about the requests and invitations that come your way and fill your cup with only those commitments that provide you with meaning and purpose.
Yes.
So important.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And one thing I've learned personally is to slow down a little bit because I think sometimes we're presented with opportunities or, you know, whatever it might be. And we sometimes feel like we have to respond maybe immediately or we're just caught up in the moment. And I think sometimes slowing down and waiting to respond can be really beneficial because mulling something over and looking at it from some different angles or talking it through with someone else or praying it over can really be helpful in really deciding, is it the right time to take that, you know, commitment on or whatever it might be, because, you know, we need to make sure that it fits with everything else we're doing on in our life or in our schedule.
Yeah. Okay, this one I feel like they might be conflicting, but you're going to explain this to me. You talk about having margins in your life, but also being flexible in your life. Explain the two. How can you do both?
Okay, so margin, just I think what we tend to do is we can tend to think that things are going to they're going to take less time than they really will. And like, for example, the other day I took my daughter to the doctor and in my mind, I'm like, oh, this will just take an hour. Well, it ended up being like 2 hours by the time, you know, the waiting room, and then we had to go get a prescription, and then they, you know, just la, 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 la. And it's like, if I would have just built in another hour, I just wouldn't have had that sense of frustration, you know? And so building in margin is helpful. And then I think the flexibility piece is that there's just things that don't go as planned, you know? And so we can, again, kind of going back to that day number one or day number two, I can do everything in my power or I can plan and strategize something. Well, then someone can get sick or someone can forget something or fill in the blank. Life happens, right? And so, again, if I've provided some margin around my planning, it's going to allow me to be more flexible. And so when something goes longer or something happens, I'm not scrambling to make up for that.
That totally makes sense. That totally makes sense.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, and the last one, knowing the times of day you are most effective. I must say that I don't fully wake up until about 10:30 a.m., but due to my job, I have to be awake a lot earlier than that, and due to the fact that I'm a mother and I have to take care of children, I do have to be alert. But I think that's such an important part, is knowing the times that you're most effective.
Yeah, and this kind of goes back to the time zones too, as much as possible. And it's not going to always be the case, but if you can, if for example, you have some really focused tasks to work on, it's ideal if you can maybe schedule those at a time when you feel the most alert or when you can be at your highest productivity level, you know, just when you know, not everyone is an early bird, you know, maybe you're a night owl. Just knowing that about yourself can be really helpful in setting up your time ultimately for you.
Oh, I've so loved these segments. Thank you so much, Morgan. Again, the name of the book is Take Back Your Time. Identify your priorities, decrease stress, and increase productivity. Who doesn't want that in their lives? Thanks again, Morgan. Stay with us. We'll be right back.
Well, I hope you've been enjoying Maggie's discussion with Morgan this week, trying to organize your life. You know, for me, that's been a bit of a challenge. I tend to overload, commit to too many things. But, you know, as I've gotten older and you're not quite as strong as you used to be, you have to make some tough decisions. I know for Arlene and I, we often process with each other and get her input on saying, this is something I really enjoy doing, but there's other things I feel I'm supposed to be doing. So it's very important that we, you know, prioritize things and then sometimes even get some help from people that we really trust to help our schedule and not get out of control so we can do the things that God has placed us on this earth to do. Well, all this month, we are taking an in-depth look at the world's best-selling and most read book. Of course, we're talking about the B-I-B-L-E, the Bible. And today we're looking how the Bible came to be. It's called the Canon of Scripture. How was that decided? Well, we have an excerpt from the documentary, The Bible and You.
What was the process of how the Bible came to be? Why were these the manuscripts chosen for the Canon of Scripture? What sets them apart?
The books in our New Testament, at least, are the books that early Christians copied and shared with each other from one place to the other the most. And so it was sort of a natural process. Nobody ever got together in a smoke-filled room and voted on which books would be okay to be in the Bible.
Emperor Constantine didn't settle the question of what books should be included or which gospels should be included. I know Dan Brown says that in the Da Vinci Code, but he's quite mistaken on that. It was the churches at large under local leadership that settled these matters in response to the recognition of, hey, these are apostolic writings. Of course they're authoritative.
But another part of the question might have to do with, well, why is it closed? Why have a closed canon at all? Their basic criterion was, does this document testify to the core values of the faith? Is it suitable for reading in church? If they approved it for reading in church, that meant they thought it was consistent with the basic core of church teaching.
Why were other manuscripts found later, such as the Gospel of Thomas, not included?
The canon, the list that we now have, was a list that was chosen sometime around the 350s, sometime between 325 and 375, and some was put out, some was kept in. The importance, actually, of all the material that's out is that you don't really understand what's in unless you know that was a choice. If you thought, for example, there was only four versions of the gospel and we got them all in there, then you see there's all these other ones. Wow, so now I can understand these ones because they wanted this type in and the other type out. So it is an act of exclusion, as all canons are.
I can see why the early church rejected the Gnostic Gospels produced in the second and third centuries, because the Gnostic Gospels denied the reality of the incarnation. They denied the humanity of Jesus.
When we think about the Gospels, we have copies or fragments of dozens of Gospels outside our New Testament Gospels. Very few historians would consider many of them at all as serious sources for reconstructing who Jesus was and what he said. They can be very informative for informing us about second, third, or fourth century Christianity. But there are very few cases, the most famous case being the Gospel of Thomas, where some very serious scholars have thought, hey, we might have some authentic ancient traditions that go back to Jesus in this document. And those are issues that scholars debate. By and large, no one would confuse the non-canonical Gospels with the canonical Gospels in terms of their historical reliability.
I absolutely love learning more about the Bible, the origins of it, why it's credible, why it's historically accurate. So fascinating. Did you know there was 5 billion copies of the Bible sold in the world? And it's been translated, or parts of it have been translated, into 2,200 dialects and languages. This is a book that is not just a great book to read, might not just be, you know, good suggestions for your life. This book literally has the power to transform your life. And you know, you can't say that about other books. That's why we made it a priority to get it into your hands this month, this year of the Bible, as our thank you gift to you for your generous support of this ministry. For any gift of $45 or more, we would love to send it to you. You can give us a call at 1-800-265-3100. You can give online at crossroads.ca/passion. And we are so thankful for all that you do to keep this program going strong. Well, speaking of the Bible, we're going to dive into it right now with some practical advice on how to navigate through the New Testament. Here's Pastor Carmen Bokma.
We're talking about how to read the Bible, and we're going to spend some time talking about the New Testament. That's that second half of the Bible, and it has 27 books in it. So if you're looking at your Bible, kind of go to that second half. And what the New Testament is, it's made up mostly of accounts of the life of Jesus. See, these are called the Gospels. Then you start to see the account of the early church, how the church began, and the rest of the New Testament really is letters. It's like we get to read the mail of other people, written to people and some of those churches. So if you're considering reading the Bible or are new to it all, this is a great place to start. start with the life of Jesus. Those are those first four books, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. They're all accounts of when Jesus walked on this earth, and this is going to be the best place to encounter Jesus and learn who he was. You can read his words and see his stories and see how often he turned culture on its head. And in a subversive way, he was moving forward the plan that God had all along to restore relationship with us and him. In John, which is one of those gospels, Jesus is described as the Word and as the light. He's the one that God gave us to show us, to shine light, and to speak into how we should shape our lives. And so as we talk about how to read the Bible, start with Jesus' life. See, the gospels are also so important because they're showing us the culmination of what that plan is that God had for us. God began that at the very beginning of the Bible, saying, I want to be in relationship with my people, and here's where we see that happen. The gospels are telling us about the death and the resurrection of Jesus, and this is what changed everything. There were all kinds of promises in the Old Testament that point to this. That old way of doing everything can be changed because of Jesus. Jesus brought in a new way, and it wasn't just for the people in the New Testament, it's for us too. So as you explore the Bible, sit with this Easter story and realize this is where you can find yourself. This entire story of the Bible is the story of God and you and how he wants to be in relationship with you. And so after those four books that talk about the life of Jesus, there's this one book called Acts. This comes after Jesus dies and is resurrected and goes back to heaven. And the people that are left are figuring out how do we live life the way Jesus wanted to. And this is the beginning of the church, the early church. It's of the movement, the starting of that movement of people learning to follow the way that Jesus lived. And that's you and I. That has still continued as we live. You may or may not be familiar with church. That may be not a part of what you do, but this is where we find ourselves. And the book of Acts highlights the explosion of the church, the people coming to know Jesus and how to live that out. And then the rest of the New Testament really are a bunch of letters written from leaders that are following Jesus to other people saying, here's how you as a community of people can best live the way Jesus wants you to. And that's also a beautiful place for us to go to learn how we are instructed to live out what the words of Jesus are for us. So wherever you find yourself trying to figure out how to read the Bible, as you sit in the New Testament, you're going to find instruction for your life. You're going to learn more about who Jesus is for you. And you're going to see examples of how other people imperfectly tried to live that out. As you look at the Bible and start to read any of the pages, know that it's going to point you to Jesus and what that means for the full life that he has for you.
Hey, thank you very much, Carmen. I love the book of Acts. Now, you know my background as a sportscaster.
Yeah.
So there'd be like, a game would last 2.5 hours, and then you get it down to like a minute. It's like highlights, right?
Okay.
And that's what the book of Acts is. It's these highlights, but it's awesome. Jesus doing these miracles. All these awesome things are happening. And so if you go into the book of Acts, it's just amazing because you hear how the church started, why the church starts. It's great. Now, I was going to ask you a question, though.
Oh.
Do you take the Bible for granted, Cheryl? Everybody's watching.
Yes.
You do?
I'm sure. I know we do. I think we all do, in a sense, right? Because you travel to countries all over the world where people literally are giving their lives for the chance to read the Bible. And yet sometimes we get so busy, we can't even fit it into our day. Sometimes I can't fit it into my day. Like that morning you got up this week.
Yeah, when I could.
When you were late.
I know, and I'm like you too. Like I think I've got many translations of the Bible. This Passion Bible is really to help you, with the modern language. It's great. But I think as I've traveled and, you'd be in a village where they had one Bible for the whole church or handing out a Bible to somebody that had literally been praying for it. You see how they embrace it. These tears start to flow and you go, what? I'm going to take this book more seriously. So we love the Bible and we love you. Thanks for watching.
Bye.
Thank you for your ongoing support of Crossroads, a member of the Canadian Council of Christian Charities. You can write to Crossroads, P.O. Box 5100, Burlington, Ontario, L7R 4M2.
Cheryl Weber's wardrobe provided by Melanie Lynn.